Hey everybody, my name is Lazaro Diaz. Today we're going to be discussing, as you can see in the background, dual stack, which is between IPv4 and IPv6. I can't do this. This is not me. All right. I'm going to have a boot camp July 22nd. All right. Next week is going to be from 7 p.m. Eastern to 10 p.m. Eastern time. Yes, it's at night. All right. It's going to run for 3 hours. You're going to learn everything you need to know about the CCNA 200-125. So you better get it today. This is for 7 days. This is for a 7-day boot camp, 3 hours a day, 21 hours. All right? Then you're going to have me live online so you can ask questions. If you have any doubts, concerns, or issues after I explain to you and we go through tons of labs. All right? Because I'm going to get you ready to get that certification. All you got to do, though, look at the description below. That's where the link to register will be, because it's going to be at globed.net. So look at the one below, and don't worry, I do not talk like that, like this. That's not me. All right, I'm going to be there for you to teach you, to show you, all right, how to pass your certification. I'm going to give you everything that you need, all the resources that you require to get the 200-125 before the deadline in February, okay, for the new CCNA. I hope to see you in the bootcamp. Welcome everybody to the CCNA 200-125 certification lab. Here, you're gonna see a minimum of 90% of all the topics that you can encounter in your CCNA certification, right, the 200-125. And I say that because this is obviously the packet tracer, all right? And it doesn't support a lot of things like DMVPN. You won't be able to do that, all right? It doesn't support MPLS, okay? But you can do eBGP. You can do, you know, your routing protocols. You were going to be doing STP. We're going to be doing a whole bunch of things. Ether channel, that's why you see on this side right here, you see this is paired, right? We have two pairs of wires. We're going to aggregate them with Ether channel as we go along this particular lab. But this is also to show you that you don't need to create this humongous lab with 20 or 30 or 40 different routers. This is more than enough devices for you to create what you'll see. So in this particular, I like to call it episode, all right, what we're going to do is we're going to handle this portion right here. So we'll be doing inter-VLANs. We'll be creating VLANs. We'll be assigning VLANs. We'll be doing BTP domains. We'll be trunking ports, inter-VLANs. We'll do actually Ether channel. Okay, that's why that's there. All right, we'll be configuring also this for this interface, right? We'll, on this router, we'll put this IP address. I'm not going to be worried too much about this side of it. We're going to be doing DHCP. All right. So with that said, let's get started. Okay. The very first thing that I like to do is to make sure that the devices that are statically assigned have their IP addresses, like this server right here. Because this server is going to be multifunctional for a lot of different things. All right. It's going to be our TFTP, because if you click on it, right, let's not talk about it so much, but start taking a look at things. If you look at it, it could run as a DHCP server, which we're not going to do, but we'll use it as a TFTP. We can use it as a DNS. It could be our syslog server. It could be our NTP server. We can use it as email. All right, so there's a million things, and we can even change the index file of HTML if you want to see your name on the browser, right? So I guess, you know what? Let me do that right now, because that's one of the things that I like to do, because it's just fun. All right, and I'm going to change your Cisco packet tracer right here, and I'm just going to put Lazaro. Yeah, all in caps, Lazaro, JDS. That's one thing you'll learn about me. I like doing everything in caps. So I'm going to save that. Yes, override it. All right. And now what I'm going to do is I'm going to make sure. Now, listen, a lot of people like to go to the config tab. Don't do it that way, please. Go to your desktop. This is a more realistic version of how you're going to be putting your IP addresses in there. So I'm going to put 192.168.10.1. Yes, this is my IP scheme. This is my network. I do what I want. Tabit is going to put the default mask, and that's what we're using. And then I'm going to go 192.168.10.254. And I am my own DNS server, so I'm going to do 192.168.10.1. Okay, I'm going to close that. Wrong DNS. What did I put? I don't know what I put. 192.168.1.10.1. Sorry, 10.1. All right, so we got 192.168.10.1 255.255.255.0 is the mask. 192.168.10.254 is our gateway, and 10.1, which is us, is the actual server. So you can go ahead and do that. You can do whatever you want. This is your network. Okay, some rules here. All right, so we're gonna call it LAZ.com, right? LAZ.com, and the IP address is that's gonna resolve that name is gonna be 192.168.10.1, and then we're gonna add that. Now, obviously, this is not the way you would do it in a real DNS server to do name resolution. You do things like four lookup zones. Then after you create a four lookup zones, you create a pointer record, and then you can do a reverse lookup zone. So it's completely different if you're doing it on an actual Microsoft server. This is a packet tracer server, and we're here to learn what? CCNA, okay? So, and make sure, you see how that's off? You wanna make sure that you turn it on. This is, you know, newer, older versions of the packet tracer, this will be on. This newer version of the packet tracer, which is still old, it's not the newest one, okay? It would have it off. So just make sure the DNS is on, okay? So I'm gonna go ahead and go to my desktop tab. I'm gonna go to my browser. And since you see I'm plugged into the switch, I have a green light. I should be able to. First, let's do it by IP, 192.168.10.1. And you can see it's not resolving anything. I'm putting the IP address, right? But let's put in LAZ.com. LAZ.com. Well, let's close it. So I don't want you to think, oh, it's already there. LAZ just it's making believe. LAZ.com. And there it is. So now it actually looked for the DNS server, all right, and then it popped it in there. Obviously, we're in Ethernet network, we're doing ARP, ladies and gentlemen. We need a couple things, don't we? Source MAC address, destination MAC address, source IP address, destination IP address, and a port number. In this case, it would be port 80, all right? And our destination MAC address is us. What? I guess, yes, it is us. Because we're the ones that's serving this. We're not going outside this right here. We're resolving ourselves. All right, so we got the IP address set on this one. And then here, you can see that it says static, but we're gonna put it dynamic. And I'm gonna wait, because the packet tracer is kind of goofy sometimes. If you don't wait for things to happen, you run into problems. So I'm gonna click on that. And don't think that we're not gonna run into problems, we will. And there will be some of them will be our own mistakes where we put wrong IPs or point things in the wrong direction, or it could just be the packet tracer. We put in a bad cable, right? Or a bad PC and we need to replace it. All right, so that's just the way it is. All right, this is IT, it's full of surprises. So now we got that squared away with our end devices, which are going to be facing our access ports. And that's one thing I want to focus on as well. We're in an Ethernet network. All the end devices that you see here, okay, they should, these ports or these links, all right, are considered, or the ports actually, are considered access ports. Considered, I'll say it again, considered access ports. That's what we call them. Are they actually access ports at the moment? No, their mode is dynamic auto, okay, auto, all right. We need to literally, when we create VLANs, we need to go ahead and tell it to, hey, you know, go ahead and you're going to be an access port, you're going to be a trunk port, and that's just the way things run here, okay? I'm going to fast forward through time a little bit, some of these didn't turn green yet, and this I don't like already, it's two ambers, these guys are not going to afford at all, but that's okay. All right, so let's see what's going to happen, all right, when we get into span tree later on in the lab. Right now, let's see if we can get inter-VLAN connectivity going, and we can get Ether channel going as well. All right, now, we're going to go here, because the naming, right, and also creating the VLANs. The way I like to do it is I go to my core switch, all right, and let's put the lab where we can see we're working on just enough, okay? So I can go ahead and put this right here and I can open up where we're working and still see IP addresses and things of that nature. Okay, It's the CLI right here. Let's open this up. All right, cool. So the first thing I want to do is I'm going to name it. All right, I'm going to do config t. Oh, conf t. Now, I do abbreviate. In your certification exam, you're probably going to have to type configure t or, you know, or configure terminal. But try config t or conf t, and it may just work. All right, the tab does work, question mark does work. You don't get deducted points. It's not a big deal. All right, so I'm going to give it a host name. Host name, and that's just going to be my core switch. That's it. No spaces in the name. You can use underscores, but you cannot use spaces. All right, core one, core two, core three, SW core one, you know, whatever you want to call it. Don't get too crazy. I've seen very crazy long 50 characters. It looks more like a sentence than a name. All right, so don't get too silly with the name. All right, so one of the things that is admin commands, right? So we're going to do enable, password, and you do the same thing on the routers, password, Cisco, and we'll do things very generic, enable, secret, student, and then we're going to do service, password. I'm going to tab that. See that? If you tap enough of the command, it's just tab it, it'll put it in there for you. I'm going to do a message of the day banner, MOTD, and I'm going to use a dollar sign because the delimiting character, what you start with, you must end with. So that's very important, and that's what they're looking for in the certification. Hello, I'm just going to put a hello message, which is really not a hello. It's like, get out or go to jail, okay, type of message. And then we're going to use DNS, all right? So we're going to do IP domain, which is already on, but I just want to show you the command that turns on DNS lookup, because if you want to turn it off, you need to say no IP domain hyphen lookup. And then I'm going to do IP domain hyphen name. I'm going to say last.com. This will be created on our DNS server, right? And then we're going to do IP name server, IP name hyphen server. And we're going to point it to the 10.1. 192.168.10.1. Okay, that's our name server. Awesome. So then we got that squared away. We're going to create a username. I know that in the books that you have from Cisco Press, Todd Lamley, myself, okay, and other books, they don't include this as housekeeping. I do. All right, username, LDS, and then I question mark it and I say, okay. Privilege, right? What privilege? 15, 1 through 15, all right? And you can just Google, all right, what are the different privilege levels, all right? And it'll tell you what each one does and the most common ones used, all right? So the lower the privilege level, the less stuff you can do. If you use privilege level 1, you'll be stuck in user mode. 15, you're an administrator on the router. You can do whatever you want, all right? And that's what you need to focus on. It's if you want to know what each one does, because you want to know, then Google it. All right. Privilege 15, password. Here you can pick 0 or 7. 0 specifies an encrypted password. 7 is secret. Well, I have the IP, not the IP, the service password hyphen encryption command. So that one's going to encrypt it any plain text passwords, past, present, and future. So I'm just going to put 0, and I'm going to put Cisco as well. All right. Now that I got that done, because I have a domain name and because I have a host name, I can start configuring stuff for SSH. So I'm gonna do IP SSH. And why would I wanna use SSH? Because SSH is encrypted, right? Telnet is not. So why would you still use Telnet SSH? So IP SSH, authentication retries, you know I tab that. I'm only gonna let you do it 3 times. I'll allow you to try to log in 3 times with SSH, I'm going to do IP, SSH, and then it is a timeout. So if you are goofing around and not doing anything on the router, you're not typing anything, your session will time out at 120 seconds. Now, I can do the crypto keys. Now, because I have a host name and I have a domain name. If I wouldn't have either one of those, or none of those, I would not be able to do the crypto keys. So I'm going to do crypto key generate RSA. I'm going to hit enter. And it says, listen, you can do from 360 to 2048 for your general purpose keys. Choosing a key module greater than 512 may take a few minutes. 512 is too little. 1024 is too little. I used to use 1024. I used to use 512, to be honest with you. But at least do 2048, okay? So, because even 1024 has been cracked. So 2048 would be, I guess, a minimum that I would choose, or higher, okay? Just remember the overhead on the router that it will take when it's encrypting everything. Now we're gonna go to the line con zero. Now watch what happens. It tells me, hey, SSH 5 enabled, SSH 1.99, the version SSH 1.99 has been enabled. Oh, okay, no problem. So that's the version of SSH that's enabled, cool. So I'm gonna do line con zero, I'm gonna do password, Cisco, log in, and this is where usually everything stops. I don't stop there, I say log in local. For your cert, you'll stop at login. If you're that one individual, one in a thousand, okay, that gets the login local, that means you're using that local username and password that you created, okay? So I'm gonna hit enter. And these are very important commands I'm gonna type in now. Login, synchronous, yes, I'm tabbing, and exec hyphen timeout minutes, the first number is minutes, I'm gonna put 10 minutes, 15 seconds, okay? Here I would normally put 00, but just so you can see the difference, 10 minutes, 15 seconds. The first number is minutes, the second number is seconds, okay? Login synchronous doesn't interrupt your typing. That's what it is, you're in sync with the router. So if you're typing something and you get some sort of logging message back of what just happened on the router, then it just won't interrupt your typing. You'll still be on the same line, you'll be okay, it won't cut your command in half, which is pretty cool, I like it. All right, and then this is repetitive. Line VTY 0 space 15, Y 0 space 15. The default tenant lines are 0 through 4. This switch can do 15, so I'm gonna do 15 lines. All right, I'm gonna open them up all. Password, Cisco, login, local, but very important, transport, input, question mark, what do you want to do? Do you want to do all protocols, no protocols, SSH, or telnet? In the real world, it all depends on your company that you work for. Certifications, it could be SSH or telnet. They'll have it pre-configured for you, or they'll tell you what to configure if that's the case. But for live purposes, I put all so I can demonstrate both. All right. And then I'm going to actually put an IP address for VLAN 10. Okay. Because normally what you do is you put an IP address for the management VLAN, which is VLAN 1. Okay. But for now, I want to go ahead and do an IP address for VLAN 10. But we haven't created that yet, so I'm not worried about that yet. So I'm going to do WR. And those are your basic housekeeping commands, okay, on the switch, okay, that I call basic housekeeping. All that, okay? That's not what the Cisco book says or anything like that, or objectives. I put that in there, okay? Now, we're going to create a VLAN. We're going to create all three VLANs, VLAN 10, 20, and 30, okay, on the core, but I'm not going to assign them. So I'm going to do VLAN 10, enter, name, let's just call it, because it's first floor, second floor, third floor, so this is going to be first, let's just call it deck, okay, first deck, VLAN 10, VLAN 20, name, second deck. Okay, yes, I'm not putting underscores. I know, I just don't want to. VLAN 30, name, third. Spell it correctly, third deck. All right, so we got three VLANs, but we need to verify this to make sure that it actually took. So we're gonna go ahead, in the certification, you need to do exit. Hopefully you can do config T and do a copy run start, okay? And then that way, it copies it from RAM, the run, to the startup config file, which is in NVRAM. And then you can do a show VLAN brief, all right? And you'll see you'll have your VLANs right there, but they're not assigned. They're not assigned to any ports at all, and I'm not going to, okay? So, why did I close the switch? Open that switch back up. All right, so now what I'm gonna do is, very important, I'm gonna go ahead and tweak my VTP. So I'm gonna do config T, and I'm gonna go do, which you cannot do in the certification, do show VTP status, and this is, or, okay. Do show off, right? Oh, I forgot to show. I said it, but I didn't type it. Do show VTP stat, all right, which you cannot do the do. So you have to go back to privilege mode to do this command. But be very familiar with this screen. Be very familiar with this particular screen right here, especially the revision number. The higher the revision number, the latest and greatest information you have, and the operating mode, which Cisco recommends one server, the rest of them clients. One server, the rest of them clients, okay? So we go ahead and we're gonna leave it as a server, but we are gonna have a domain name. Why do we wanna leave it as a server? Because we want to be able to not only send and receive frames, but because clients can do the same thing, but we wanna be able to create, change, delete VLANs, which you can't do as a client, okay? So there's three modes. You have server, you have client, and transparent, which is, I call the greedy one, because it doesn't like to share its VLAN database. It will not update its VLAN database with anybody else. It's just gonna pass the information on forward. So we're gonna go ahead and put a VTP domain name. Now, this is not like DNS. There's nothing to do with that. So VTP domain, and guess what I'm gonna call it? LAS, okay? Now that that's there, we want to verify that, right? So we're going to up arrow and we do show VTP stat again, and then you see LAS that's there, okay? LAS. Now there are some admin commands that I didn't type because I'm saving that for the router, like the clock and stuff like that. But for right now, this is good enough, all right? This is good enough. All right, so what we're going to do next is the following. We have the VLANs, we're going to trunk the ports. Now, which ports do we trunk? If we look at our topology, we got F0, it's really 1, 2, and 3, and then 24. Okay, so we're going to do int range F0/1-3, enter, switch port mode trunk. These are layer 2 switches, not layer 3. You see how they turned amber? These are not layer 3 switches. You don't have to tell it the type of encapsulation you want. It will automatically put 802.1q. And then int F0/. Now I could have put a comma, but I didn't. All right. Because sometimes the package tracer does it, sometimes it doesn't. So why risk it? So int F024. Don't forget that one. Switch port mode trunk. You see how I'm tabbing it out big time. All right, so what I'm gonna do, show, I went control Z, show int trunk, okay? And we see that 1, 2, and 3 are on. 24, I did trunk it, but since the router's not on that interface, then it's not gonna happen, not gonna happen. All right, so we got that done. We got the core for now. We got the core switch done with what we want as of the moment, UWR, or WR, I should say. All right, which is the same thing as copy run start, which is what you will do in your certification. And now I'm gonna go to the first floor, all right, which is down here. And I'm gonna do the same thing. I'm gonna put it right there. I'm gonna open it up to there. I'm gonna bring it up to here so you guys can see everything that I'm doing. CLI, all right. So I don't know what to call this switch yet because I don't know, let's switch to the first floor actually. So config T. Pretty simple, host name, first deck is what we called it, first deck, all right? And then we're gonna change these to clients, VTP domain, the operating mode of the switch, VTP domain, client. So now that that's done, and oh no, I did the wrong thing, I apologize. No VTP domain client, all right? Okay, so what's gonna happen? Exactly that, I'm gonna get a mismatch. So unfortunately, that no VTP domain thing, yeah, that doesn't work. So what I'm gonna do, luckily it was just this switch, I'm gonna delete that switch, okay? Because with the packet tracer, yeah, you're gonna have to end up deleting things. All right, so with on port 3 here on the top, and this is port 20 and 21. So get that. I'm gonna bring in a new switch, okay? Which is cool, because hey, this happens. This happens. If you think it's not gonna happen to you, that's not the case. We need crossover cables. We go to port 20, to port 20. Why? Because I chose those. I like to use the higher ports, okay, for my internet networking devices. That's just me though, okay? That doesn't really have to be everybody else in port 21. Fast forward through time. All right, awesome. Now you see how one's green, one's amber? Nah, see, I like that. All right, that's what I like to see. Now, oh, and I forgot to plug in this cable right here, which is port 24 to port 3. I think this is third deck, right? All right, so we're gonna go try this again. Okay, no biggie, no diggity, right? No doubt. All right, put it right there. CLI. All right, we're gonna do enable, conf T, host name, first deck. Okay, and now we're gonna do VTP mode client, because the VTP name has to trickle down by itself. Now you see it's not doing it. I'm gonna fast forward through time, making sure that the things that need to turn amber, or turn amber, turn green, okay, awesome. Go back up here, VTP mode client. I'm gonna hit enter, do WR, and then control Z, which you cannot do to WR, you have to do copy run start from here, but I'm gonna do a show VTP stat. All right, and what I see is, no, not show VTP stat, show VLAN brief, I'm sorry, show VLAN brief, I'm saying, where's the VLANs? Show VLAN brief, and you can see that my VLANs came down automatically. So now, this is my third deck, so I'm gonna assign VLAN 30 to a range of ports. And look, I forgot to plug in the computer. Let's plug in the computer to port one here. All right, so I'm gonna come in here and I'm going to go ahead and do config T. All right, I'm gonna do int range F0/1-15, something I like to do, okay? And let's even put 10, just in case we're running to, you know, I'm plugging into somewhere else. All right, switch port mode access. Now, they're access ports. Now, switch port access, VLAN 30. All right, and since I am here, I am going to turn off span tree because I don't want span tree. You see that thing is still amber? I'm gonna fast forward through time. Fast forward through time. Come on now. There it goes, turn green. Because span tree is looking at those ports. I don't want that. All right, so I'm gonna do switch port, not switch port, spanning tree, sorry. Spanning tree, port fast. That turns off port fast on that range that I'm in, that's 01 through 10. I'm gonna hit enter, boom, right? Turned off port fast. It's giving me, whoa, hey, you're, you know, connecting hubs and cons is an issue. So it gives you a caution statement, okay? It gives you a caution statement. So now what we're gonna do is guard against anything that's an internet networking device that you can plug into these ports. So it will shut down the port, okay? And well, it shut down the port when it sees any kind of BPDUs, which stand for Bridge Protocol Data Units. We're gonna do spanning tree. All right, BPDU guard enable. All right, so that's looking to see if there's any BPDUs, anybody didn't get the memo. I plugged in the switch, in one of the ports that I turned off span tree. Now it's gonna say, wait a minute, I'm not gonna go ahead and I'm not gonna allow you through. I'm gonna go ahead and shut down this port, put it in ERR disable. Now we're gonna do port security. Take a little step further, right? Switch port hyphen security. That turns it on. I'm gonna up arrow. I'm gonna do MAC sticky, which means switches by default learn MAC addresses dynamically, and it puts it inside the MAC address table or the CAM table dynamically. But in this case, it will learn it dynamically. But since I have the sticky command, it will place it in the writing table as static, as I actually typed it in. So it will be there forever and a day, okay? And then I'm gonna do up arrow again. I'm only gonna allow one because that's just the way I am, all right? And then if you violate my rule, because I am a ruthless person, and that's what Cisco says, we're gonna shut down the port, all right? And for the moment, it's the same thing. Now all you gotta do is the same thing on all the other two switches for VLAN 20 and VLAN 10.